We're very fortunate today to have Dr. Susan Wilczynski with us today. Dr. Wilczynski is a professor of special education at Ball State University and formerly the executive director of the National Autism Center. And we're here today to talk about the use of evidence-based practice strategies in applied behavior analysis. So, Susan, if I can call you that,
absolutely.
Welcome very much.
Thank you.
Thanks for being here.
Very happy to be here.
Fantastic. Let me start off with a question. Why is evidence-based practice such an important issue? I mean, applied behavior analysis has for years been emphasizing how important it is to do experimental work. Talk to me about how evidence-based practice fits into the whole area of autism services, if you would, Susan.
Sure. Well, evidence-based practice is really a great decision-making framework. It's completely compatible with everything we've always done in applied behavior analysis. Evidence-based practice involves integrating the best available evidence along with professional judgment, as well as the client values and the context in which people live. Applied behavior analysis is not something that happens in a sterile environment. It's something that happens in real-world context, which are complex, and selecting the right treatment that produces the best outcomes involves integrating all of that information.
So it sounds like it's a multi-step process.
Absolutely. And it's sometimes an iterative process, meaning that we start out with a practical question. We have a client, they're experiencing some challenge, and we start with this practical question and we look to the literature. What is the best evidence that's available to answer this practical question? But we can't look at that in isolation without also looking at the client values and the context. By pulling all of this information together, we can start saying, okay, this might be, we have a series of options, and we think this might be the best option to consider. It also then gives us the chance, if this is the best treatment, how does it need to be adapted for this client in this context? So how can we make sure that the teacher can implement this or the parent can implement this intervention effectively? We put that intervention into place, but it doesn't stop there, of course. Behavior analysts have always known progress monitoring is essential. We assess whether or not that's we're actually producing the outcome we're trying to get to. It may be that we improve an outcome, but not enough. And so now we might need to go back and assess how do we adapt this treatment further, or how do we add another component or alter the treatment altogether, depending on what the outcomes are. It's an iterative process in that we keep working toward an optimal outcome.
So it sounds like the addition of the database decision-making monitoring clinical progress is a critical component, actually.
Absolutely.
So there's a multi-step process right here, and I'm going to ask you to review each of those steps. But
sure.
Before we get there, let me ask you the bigger context aspect mm-hmm. of it. Evidence-based practice has been talked about in medicine for a number of years. Is it a new thing to apply behavior analysis? Is it an ethical obligation for applied behavior analysts to consider evidence-based practice and incorporate that as their practice model? What is the rationale to move this over into applied behavior analysis?
Sure. Evidence-based practice did start in medicine around 1990, and there was a recognition that when you make a decision about medical treatment, you don't make that in a vacuum as well. You consider the client. An example might be, let's say I have a sinus infection. My doctor's going to have a conversation with me. He's not going to just write his script. He's going to ask me, Susan, I think what is probably a good antibiotic for you, you have to take it for 10 days twice a day. Do you think you can do that? And my answer is no. I'm lucky if I'll make it to day 7. So then he'll say, all right, here's a better alternative for you. What was amazing to me was that in medicine, physicians had recognized how critical it was to involve the client in those decisions that were made, but also that they had to apply good professional judgment to produce the best outcome for their patients. Well, many different fields recognize the importance of this kind of a decision-making framework. And so if you look at psychology and speech-language pathology and occupational physical therapy, one after the other professions adopted this model. And in applied behavior analysis, we've been a little bit later than everyone else in pushing for an evidence-based practice of applied behavior analysis. But starting several years ago, you started seeing presentations at ABAI. And then a couple of years ago, you started seeing articles appear. Tris Smith had an article appear. Tim Slocum, along with a bunch of us that are really
including
dedicated
you.
To this topic,
yes,
published an article on the topic. And you also see them in other relevant journals related to behavior analysis. So I think we're making some forward movement. And part of it, again, is just I think if you've got a good decision-making model that integrates everything we've talked about in applied behavior analysis, it helps the practitioner to remember each step that's critical to produce those best outcomes. And also, you're right, it does help us comply with our ethical standards. If you look at our current ethical standards and the upcoming professional codes that are in effect in January 2016, you see over and over again reference to the importance of having a conversation with the client before you even select the treatment. Considering environmental variables, contextual variables, and that's not just environmental variables that maintain behavior, but what are the environmental variables that are relevant to the likely success of an intervention? We need to make sure that the behavior change agents are motivated, and we're considering how do we arrange the environment so that they can successfully implement the intervention, as well as, is this something that's acceptable to them? All of those issues are not just part of evidence-based practice of applied behavior analysis, but it's part of our ethical code.
And Susan, that ethics code clearly emphasizes effective treatment and individualized treatment, both of which seem to be completely compatible with the evidence-based model, right?
Absolutely. And it's tricky because many people think, if there's a list somewhere, we have to do what's on that list. And they see it as completely invariant, and they go into an environment and say, absolutely, this is the only choice. Well, as behavior analysts, what we should know all along is that there's never just one solution to a problem. We are fortunate with our rich history, we have research on such a broad range of topics that help us identify what is the right treatment. If I identify the function of a behavior and I want to generate a function-based intervention, I have many, many choices. I don't have just one. So it's very reasonable and consistent with our ethical code to include this information in this decision-making process.
Well, it sounds like a very reasonable model. Now, I'm interested that in your observation that applied behavior analysis was a little late into moving into this particular area. And I'm wondering if you've speculated at all on why that might be. Is it the case that we came from what you might call a different baseline, so to speak? I mean, we have this rich empirical experimental literature out there about what works, but you're saying that you need to go beyond just that.
That's right.
And maybe we were somewhat complacent in saying, oh, we got what works. There we have this list. But we didn't think about all the other things that needed to be considered in terms of selecting and treating and implementing treatments then evaluating the efficacy of those treatments with an individual client. Is that a possible explanation?
It is. I think a lot of what happened was behavior analysts said, well, we've always used data, so we've always done evidence-based practice. Mm-hmm. And of course, data is a critical component of a good evidence-based practice approach. But it's not the only component. What's been interesting to me, if I look through our history, I can look back to our first decade with people making reference to social validity, for example. People talked about the importance of context and that the consumer's the one who decides whether or not the treatment has actually been deemed effective. So from the beginnings, we have said this is important. What we've had a harder time doing necessarily is integrating both of those pieces. So what I really like about the evidence-based practice of applied behavior analysis model is that it helps guide you through that process. It reminds you that one component does not overtake the other. A good behavior analyst is able to integrate all of that information.
And that's a great point, actually. You know, early on, we started talking about social validity and mm-hmm. consumer satisfaction. But the way we framed it originally is, let's do that as post hoc, essentially.
That's right.
And now what you're saying is that the way to ensure social validity and consumer satisfaction is to think ahead of time about how do you individualize treatments within the constraints of what works effectively.
Absolutely.
To make it so that we're meeting the consumer's needs and producing meaningful, socially valid effects for the consumers.
Absolutely. And the other component, of course, is treatment fidelity. We can identify an efficacious treatment, one that we say there's lots of research that says this works. But if the people in the real environment can't implement the treatment accurately, we're not actually doing that intervention. And so if we are better at identifying, okay, what are the relevant variables in this environment? What resources can be reallocated? What level of training is necessary? Does the person find this acceptable so that when I remove myself from the situation, that they're able to continue the treatment? Those are the things that are going to, in the long run, produce the best outcomes. And so this is just a reminder, all of these pieces that we've worked on through the years, from social validity and treatment fidelity to, of course, a database decision-making framework, all of those are integrated in the evidence-based practice of applied behavior analysis model.
That's a great point I hadn't thought of previously, is the connection between doing acceptable interventions within the context and within the skill set of the teacher or the parent or whatever, in the likelihood that they're going to accurately and consistently implement that.
That's right.
And part of that sounds like it would be a selection process, clearly. Mm-hmm. I would also imagine, Susan, that part of it is that the teachers and the parents become more adept and more skilled as they go on, and you might be able to gradually up what you're expecting them to do as by the time therapy ends, but nevertheless, you've got to be sensitive to that issue, because it's not like you treat something and you can take it away and it never have to worry about it again.
That's right.
You've got to make sure that some of the management strategies are ongoing as
yes.
part of a durable treatment, essentially.
I agree with you 100%. The other thing I would say is, yes, people will develop more skills as they go along if they've received proper supports as they go along. Mm-hmm. But parents and teachers don't always get those proper supports. So sometimes, for example, they'll get someone come in and do an all-day training to teach them an intervention. I don't know anyone who would feel comfortable going to a surgeon who'd gone to an all-day training and sat and was talked to have that person perform the surgery. And so making sure that our training models are consistent with what produces the best skill for that person. So someone might have served kids with autism for 2, 3, 5, 20 years, but never really received the training that they need. The other thing that I would say is, again, real life is complicated. And so it may be that you have, a parent who has developed a lot of skills over time, but then has a parent who falls ill. Well, now all of a sudden, that very complicated intervention that was working great is something they can no longer implement with fidelity. Of course, we don't look at the parent and say, well, you just need to try harder, right? What we do is we go in and we say, okay, how do we still get a good possible outcome and make it so that it's more manageable? Is there something we can tweak or we can alter? Because we have a new contextual variable that needs to be considered.
So I like the model in particular about saying, mm-hmm. well, what are the contextual things that have an impact and pinch upon treatment delivery and treatment fidelity, be it by the BCBA or the behavioral technician or the parent or whoever's involved in the systematic delivery of that intervention. So it sounds like a great way to think about the whole process. You talked to us about initially about this whole multi-step process or evidence-based practice. Could you walk us through that process, Susan?
Sure.
If you're a BCBA and you get a case referred to you.
Well, before I go into the evidence-based practice model, my first response to that is, as a behavior analyst in practice, I would want to assess how different is my training and my experience, my skill set, from what is required in this situation. It may be that the first thing I would do would be to make a referral to someone else, or to get consultation or supervision from someone who has more experience in a given area. I'll give you an example. When I did my internship, I had a rotation where I did some feeding. I don't do feeding today. And so my reaction would be, I need to find a feeding specialist. Feeding is always so much more complicated than people think at first blush. But there may be another referral question that, well, I haven't done it in a while, and so I might just consult with someone or ask them to act as a sounding board for me. And so making that decision about whether or not a given question is appropriate for you also goes back to our ethical code.
And we call that scope of practice.
That's exactly right.
Limits on that scope of practice. And part of what you're saying, which I think is a good message for everybody, is that just because you're BCBA doesn't mean that you're of necessity competent in every possible thing that might get referred to you.
Absolutely.
You may have to supplement your training or your experience with either additional training, additional supervision, or potentially, as you're saying, consider a referral to someone who has significantly more experience. So the ultimate goal is, how do you help the client, obviously?
That's exactly right. And so where we begin with is this practical question. What is the issue at hand? Where we don't start is, oh, this is the manual that I use for all kids that come to my center, or that are in this school, or are in whatever setting you're working in. What I don't do is say, oh, this is a problem like what I did when I was in graduate school under this professor, so I should do the exact same thing. I start with the practical question. I look to the literature, and hopefully I've got a good familiarity with the literature already, but always, even if you've got a good familiarity, going and doing an updated literature search to see if anything new has come out that's relevant to that real-world question.
So what do you recommend that people do, Susan, in terms
sure.
of kind of a constrained science-focused or behavior analysis-focused literature search?
Sure. Well, the first thing I say is, as much as I love Google, it is a really dangerous tool. People use it to diagnose themselves and others. This is terribly dangerous. And they use it to identify treatments that sometimes are based on testimonials or are based on charlatans. There are so many people out there who are recognizing, again, my area is autism. And so there are, unfortunately, many people out there who will put things on the website about absolute cures and low response effort that's required, so people don't have to work very hard, but they're going to get these miracle cures. And if there was an easy way, I would love that. I would be as motivated as the next person, but it's not easy. First of all, if you're looking for more recent literature, if you have access to a university, doing a search using one of the search engines. For example, I use PsycINFO very regularly. I also am doing some research related to business and autism spectrum disorder, so I might go into one of their search engines, or to Medline if I've got a case that involves biological or medical conditions or issues. So I try to take advantage of all of those resources. Not everyone has that access, but I would say if you're looking for articles, Google Scholar is a great way to try to get articles, where you're going to get research articles that are coming up, not just testimonials. But I'll also say this, I think that part of the goal of having an evidence-based framework is when we talk about that best available evidence, there are professionals now who are doing systematic reviews. And what they're doing is they're evaluating the literature and identifying what is the quality of the research, how much research is there, how consistent are the results. And by doing that, they can pull the information together in a way that makes sense. That gives you a list that says, for this population, for example, for kids with autism, these are treatments that have been shown to be effective. And that is a great starting point. I say it's a starting point because there are some people who think, oh, good. For example, when I did the National Standards Project, you know, we pulled together experts from all over the world. We reviewed almost 800 articles and identified, okay, for kids at different ages or for this behavioral excess or deficit, what does the literature tell us? Fantastic. The reason I wanted to do that project to begin with was because I thought this is going to help parents and teachers and our communities to decide where do we want to invest our money and our energy if we want to produce really great outcomes for kids with autism. All of these systematic reviews, whether it's the National Standards Project or any other systematic review that you might find in the literature or in like the Cochrane reviews, for example, all of those also have their limitations. There is no perfect tool. So as you have mentioned, be a critical consumer. Be a critical consumer of what you see on the internet. Be a critical consumer of what research articles tell you. And be a critical consumer of these evidence-based practice guidelines. Because just as I said earlier, you might have a conversation with your doctor to find the right medical treatment for you, you also need to be well-informed and consider many different variables before you know whether or not the outcomes apply for a given client. Well, I will tell you, that's why I think professional judgment will always be critical. My goal for our field is not that we have huge volumes of technicians who simply look at a list and then pluck one from the list and apply that without reason. Our literature, as rich as it is not always going to be perfectly relevant for the practical question we start out with. And so we may have, for example, it might not be the same age group. The behavior might be different. The treatment might need to look a little bit different. Perhaps the dosage is different or the stimuli you are using might be different. In all of these cases, it requires professional judgment because we are taking from a literature base that does not perfectly match our situation. And so I don't think there's any problem with not having the exact answer and many studies on the exact question that we're asking. I don't think we'll ever be there as a field just because there's so many variants in how a problem may present and who is involved in addressing that situation. So it's not a problem doing that, except for we need practitioners and we need students to realize that this is a critical component, that going to this list and saying, well, I'm doing this effective treatment is not the best strategy to use. I have been in situations where I've seen someone who they have put an intervention in place because they saw it on a list. And they're so busy inventing a pat themselves on the back machine because they've implemented an effective intervention, except for the data, if they were collecting it, they would clearly realize that the intervention was not effective in this case. And so if you, again, that progress monitoring piece is just so important. So even when you do a great literature review or you have access to a great systematic review, the extent to which those results are going to apply in this given situation, you don't know. And that's why progress monitoring is so important.
That makes good sense.
Of course, you look at the literature before you even select an intervention, but that's that iterative process I've talked about. You want to also go back and revisit if things are not working. Is it possible that there was a relevant variable in the literature that that was different than in my real-world context?
That sounds like a very logical strategy right there, Susan. So, Susan, we've talked a little bit about going to the literature and searching out information about potentially effective interventions. Mm-hmm. What dimensions do you look for there? Do you just look for the relevance to the problem that you have facing you, or are there other dimensions you should look at and be sensitive to as you're looking at that literature?
Great question. Relevance is an essential dimension, but quality is also a critical component. Many people, when they're starting out, think, well, if it's been published, it must be good. And a lot of times, first of all, we've got a lot of journals, and not all journals publish equal quality research. But even beyond that, sometimes even in a great journal, you'll get an article published that isn't the highest quality, but it was so creative so clever, so cutting edge in an area we haven't thought about before, that it's worth publishing so that people can begin talking about it. And people can begin exploring that empirically on their own. An example that I can think of in the autism literature is social stories. When social stories first came out, there was an awful AB design that had been published. And unfortunately, people all over the country just ran out and started implementing social stories with just an AB design. And I said, wait, we need a lot more research here before we can be confident in whether or not this actually works. And if it does work, what are the parameters? And I think that, you know, knowing how well it answers the practical question that we've asked, even an effective treatment might answer that practical question very well under some circumstances and not at all well during others. So when I look at the dimensions, I look at the quality of the research, and I also look at the relevance. Now, if I were to plot out all of my studies, looking at the relevance and the quality of the research, I might say, okay, over in one corner, I've got a lot of research and it's highly relevant. This is the happiest of conditions. Because then I can say, yes, this is an intervention I absolutely should be considering in this situation. I often find that there are either studies that aren't as high of a quality, or they are high quality, but they're not exactly like the question I'm posed with right now, or they're not exactly relevant to the context I'm in right now. When that's the case, I have to use my professional judgment. Even with really good studies, I'm having to assess whether or not it's going to make a difference. I have to bring my professional experience and judgment to bear. And certainly that's even more so the case when there are low quality data, meaning that it may be that only one or two studies have been published. They're not as rigorous. They don't have the highest quality dependent variable. There's not evidence of treatment fidelity. The research design doesn't establish a clear functional relationship. It's not related to kids with autism in my case. Or all of that is in place, but no one's actually looked to see the extent to which the intervention has been effective in other settings or in other situations, which is also an important factor. So I'm going to look at all of those pieces. And yes, of course, in my ideal world, all of that comes together. I've got a lot of research. The results are consistent and favorable. But since we don't live in that ideal world, we have to use our professional judgment.
And you made a number of really critical points, I think. One of them is that you're looking at a whole body of research, not a single study. And I can't tell you how many times we've seen a splashy headline about a study that shows something, only to discover 6 months later or a year later that it's not quite the way we thought it was originally. So you're looking at kind of replicated studies, studies that test out different variations, help us understand what are the critical parameters to produce this effect and what are the limiting conditions. That's a way you think about the entire research area simply. Now, let me ask you a little bit of a controversial topic here. Would you like to weigh in on the controversy about single subject style research? Subject to zone control, which by the way is not always done with a single subject, but has multiple measures under systematic variations of independent variable versus more of a traditional randomized control trial groups comparison studies.
I think they have different purposes. And again, you want to recognize the limitations of both. So, for example, there are people that believe that a randomized clinical trial is the only way to demonstrate whether or not an intervention is effective. I think there's a huge value in randomized clinical trials, and part of the reason for that is we have a lot of evidence from medicine that an intervention can look as if it's effective when you have smaller N studies, and when you apply it in the broad population, that kind of washes out. Now, of course, none of that should come as a surprise to behavior analysts. Part of the reason we use single subject research design is because we focus on producing change for a given individual or a given classroom or whatever unit our N is in a research design. The single subject research design, one of the reasons I think it is highly valuable, it can demonstrate a clear functional relationship between the treatment and the outcome, which is essential. It is so powerful in helping me tweak if something's not just right. I can assess quickly whether or not an intervention is working or not working, and I can make changes accordingly. So I feel like I can best serve my clients when I use single subject research design. But I will also say it's much more difficult to assess the effect that it would have on a whole population. And we have to acknowledge that limitation. But I would also say with we've got weaknesses in both designs, there are so many group research designs that might show, yes, this is an effective intervention for this population, but there were many people that were part of that group that was being studied that showed no benefit and actually might have gotten worse, but the average improved. And since we focus on improving lives one at a time, we definitely want to have a huge focus on single subject research design. Both are valuable research methods.
It's nice to hear that you're pointing out the limitations and the benefits of both designs in terms of putting all together this picture of what works and what does not work. So that's good stuff. And the other thing that you said that I think was very interesting, Susan, was that part of your clinical practice looks like a single subject research design where you're doing multiple measures, trying out a treatment, evaluating the multiple measures and trying to detect how are people responding or not responding. So that's the continuity between the research side and the clinical practice side. I think that's great.
Great.
Okay. So Susan, you made a compelling case for looking at the research literature to find relevant and high quality research that might help inform one or more treatments. But there's a number of other variables that you need to think about when you're doing evidence-based practice. Can you walk us through some of those other contextual and client and therapist variables that should weigh into your design?
Sure, and I think starting with the client is a great way to start. Often people think of the client only as the person whose behavior we want to change. But from, again, our foundations in behavior analysis, we know that the client is much more broad than that. The client should include the individuals who are the behavior change agents. These people may also be a relevant component in assessing whether or not an intervention is likely to be effective. I would hope I wouldn't pick the exact same intervention for someone who's been doing the work for 20 years as I would for someone who started 6 weeks ago. I wouldn't expect the same level of treatment fidelity from both of those people. And so looking at who the client is going to be an important component. Our task list from the BACB has a lot of issues that we should be considering when we're looking at the client. I think one of the first ones it talks about is biological and medical issues. So for example, one that I've seen in a number of cases, there are people who don't have the physical stamina for one reason or another to do a certain activity for the required level of time. So, for example, we may have kids who don't have the physical capacity to hold themselves up and sit in a chair all day. People that think, oh, well, they should have 40 hours of discrete trial training in a chair for 40 hours a week when they can't even hold themselves up, they're missing a really critical variable. There's a biological variable there. So the way whether or not someone has stamina is critical. Also, if I'm looking at adolescents who are going out into the workforce, do they have the stamina to work for that length of time? Can they stand on their feet for that long? And so I can't just look at, oh, this is the intervention to develop this employment skill. I have to put along with that, do they have the physical capacity and is there something I need to do as a prerequisite skill?
So looking at some of the physical constraints of the clients are going to help you identify maybe goals as well as acceptable treatments, obviously.
That's right. But there are so many things. If you look, for example, many of the physical management systems will tell you you should not use this form of physical management with people with certain medical conditions. That's another example of how I have to consider that client value, that biological medical factor. There are also things like what medication someone is on. It can influence your ability to pay attention, for example. Even if the medication is doing what it's supposed to do, it might have a side effect that can interfere with which treatment is going to be effective in a given situation. Another issue is client preference. Most of the time when I ask students, how do you assess client preference? The only thing they can tell me is a preference assessment. And gosh, that's a really good start. But preference is not just about doing a preference assessment. Sometimes it's about assessing what is the reinforcer magnitude. Sometimes it's, do they prefer this treatment or that treatment? I have worked with a lot of clients over the years where I discuss the options with them and ask them which is the intervention that they would rather do. Or you can look at Greg Hanley's work that looked at preference for punishment and extinction procedures. So using these kinds of methodologies to assess, okay, what is better for this person? What do they deem as preferable? And of course, I assess affect. So what I do, I look at how the person is responding to the treatment. We talked about the selection process and then the implementation process. When I'm implementing an intervention, if I have a client who seems extremely unhappy, as evidenced by tantrums and crying and whining or aggressive behavior, self-injury, I know that I might want to tweak this intervention. Now, I can't say that I back off immediately and say, oh, there's no way we can do this. That's also not a good choice. But what I do want to do is look at the intervention and see, can I change this intervention in a way that helps me reach my positive goals, but still have a positive client? So preference really is important and something we should be including.
That makes great sense to me, actually. And the strategies you talk about for assessing it make perfectly good sense also. Let me ask you to speculate a little bit or think a little bit about what limits we might have there on going with client preference.
That's right. All of these client variables, we're still looking at that in the context in relationship to that best available evidence. So I would, first of all, avoid all of the treatments that have no evidence of efficacy whatsoever. But even beyond there, of course there are interventions that or goals that someone might have that are not appropriate.
One of the challenges that BCBDAs in practice have is the parents come in and say, you know what I saw on TV last night? These fantastic mineral oils, if you rub them on your child, that it cures autism. Mm-hmm. Or if you change the diet for my child, it's going to cure autism.
That's right.
And what do you tell BCBAs to say to parents?
Sure.
When they're pressuring like that, you know, because, I mean, we want to be sensitive to client preference.
That's right.
But sometimes the client preferences are not founded on good evidence.
That's right.
Sometimes they're willing to do things that might be damaging to their child in spite of their best interests. So what do you say into those conditions?
Well, first I'd like to have a conversation with them about what the literature tells us about some of those things. So, for example, with some of the diets, I go over what research tells us, even though the literature tells me that that might not make a difference. But I also like to talk to them about the potential negative side effects of those treatments. So, for example, reductions in bone density. To me, that is very frightening potential side effect of some of the dietary interventions. So I want to make sure they understand all of those things. I often also will tell people that's not my area of expertise, and so that's not something that I can particularly help with. And so it's not my place to dictate to parents whether or not they do that diet or any of the diet options that people have suggested, but I can say it's not my place to do it, and this is why.
There may be some situations where the BCBA may put on a slightly different hat. My practitioner hat comes off, and my researcher hat goes on, and if you're insisting on trying out this new intervention, and I'm positive it's not going to have any serious long-term mm-hmm. deleterious side effects, mm-hmm. I'll help you evaluate it.
That's right.
Is that a reasonable role for a BCBA to have?
What it allows us to do is to take a skill set that is fairly unique to us. Other fields do use single subject research design, but I think It's used very consistently by behavior analysts and less consistently by other professions. It allows us to bring this unique skill that we have to a situation to help make timely decisions about an intervention and realize that showing somebody that adding another intervention is not going to help is very valuable information. What I like to tell people, parents have very complicated lives. They often have so many things going on. Teachers, the same thing. So many kids in the classroom, so many demands. Adding one more intervention is hard, even when you know the treatment is very effective. So when we're getting into a more experimental area, you're taking resources, you're taking time, energy, money, and putting those resources into something that may not be effective, you want to know that as quickly as possible.
That makes great sense. And, you know, just as a cautionary note for BCBAs watching this, if you take your practitioner hat off and you put your researcher hat on, there's a set of ethical principles and guidelines that go along with that change in role. And you also have to think very carefully about, well, how do I evaluate efficacy? Mm-hmm. Because sometimes people just look at the positive symptoms like aggression or self-stim, and sometimes those decrease under some interventions, for example, pharmacological interventions. Mm-hmm. But you don't see a corresponding increase in all the deficit areas that so define the area of autism. So it is worth thinking kind of carefully about how do I evaluate impact clinically.
Absolutely. And I actually argue the same thing. There's so much money that goes into finding a cause for autism. We've already identified a lot of genetic causes for autism. It, first of all, hasn't given us a cure. But let's say it did give us some kind of a cure, meaning that the capacity to communicate improved, the capacity to learn to communicate improved, the capacity to interact socially improved. There was a reduction in stereotypic behaviors, for example. If all of that happened, we would still have a gap between where this child is now in terms of the skill set they have and where they need to be, and we would still need to address that. So whether it's a pill that they're taking related to a medication or someday a genetic intervention, will still have a critical role.
Mm-hmm. And that critical role you're thinking involves skill acquisition mainly. Is that
absolutely.
Okay. So you talked, Susan, thus far about considering client preferences and client capabilities, maybe even some biological factors. Are there other client characteristics that you want to consider as you're doing this whole evidence-based practice model?
Sure. I think one client variable, when we're looking at the client as the individual that we're changing their behavior, we want to look at what are the skills within their repertoire. Sometimes people do that by using one of the tools that have been developed, so like a VB map, for example, which is a great thing to do. But that shouldn't be the only thing that we're thinking about. We need to be thinking about behavioral cusps as well. We as behavior analysts should never be focusing on skills in isolation. We should be looking at skills as they fit together to produce a watershed effect. What skill can I work toward that will open new doors for this person? They can go into a less restrictive environment, for example, or they can begin enjoying social interactions, whereas before that really hasn't been a value to them. And so we need to focus not always on the smallest unit, although that's important, but also how do these pieces fit together? I would say the other piece that, again, to bring in, when we look at building a repertoire, we need to look at what are the prerequisite skills, but we also really need to look at what are the skills that are necessary in the supporting environment to build that skill. So when we look at the client's repertoires, of course we need to look at the client whose behavior we want to change, but we also have to look at the skill set of the people that are the behavior change agents. I then want to look at the client more broadly because I want to focus on the context. The supporting environment, I think, is a critical issue. On our task list, again, we've got issues related to the supporting environment as well as environmental and resource constraint. When I saw those on the list, I thought, goodness, what's the distinction between those? And I don't know what they had in mind, but I'll tell you how I came to think about it. When I think about the supporting environment, I think about what is the capacity to implement the intervention accurately that is unrelated to funding. So, for example, what is the training that they've had previously? What experiences have they had? How well can they collaborate? Because some professionals are very good at collaborating, others are not perceived as collaborating well, for example. And so I think, again, going back to the schools, I have worked in hospitals and schools and in homes, but I find myself regularly going back to relationships with schools. When I think about schools, there's in school psychology, an area called conjoint behavioral consultation. And this involves bringing the parents and the school together, sometimes across multiple professionals. And it's a behavioral consultation model that involves bringing people together throughout the process. I think when you have people that are accustomed to that kind of a model, for example, in their school with other kids, you're in a very different supporting environment than you are where people are used to working in silos. So I looked at supporting environment. What kind of training have people had? I can't tell you how often training means someone just sits in a room and other people talk at them while they check their email and text to other people, right? That's what we know from the adult training literature. That's not good training. And then, of course, what experience they have. Too often, I believe that there are behavior analysts who go into an environment and say, well, this is what the literature says, and so you have to do this, without giving due consideration to whether they actually have the previous training and experience. Now, does that mean that I would say, if I think this is a highly effective treatment, that I say, oh, well, I'm going to throw that out the window because they're not qualified to do that right now? Of course not. But I might put another intervention in place now, with a plan to develop the skills for the more complex intervention. And so it affects my decision-making plan. What skills and training do they have now?
So this expands the BCBA's level of responsibility to a certain degree to not only design interventions to work with an individual child, but to think about what support and training do teachers need or do parents need, and to think more than just say, here's a handout about how to do ABC recording, but to think along the lines of, well, show me, let me demonstrate what I want you to do and show me that you can do it. Seems like it's raised the bar a little bit in terms of what we expect out of our, let's say, community-based treatment mm-hmm. interfaces, essentially. Is that a safe way to put it?
I think it is. But again, the goal is, how do we identify a treatment that is most likely to produce favorable outcomes? And so, yes, in a lot of ways it is raising the bar, but in other ways it's just conceptually consistent with what we should have been doing all along. And many, many people have done that all along. And I think we've just got a greater emphasis on that now than we did before. The related concept, of course, is environmental and resource constraint. Going into an environment and saying, you have to do this because this is what the literature says, and there's no money for that, is also, as a consultant, you're just wasting their money if you do that, because they can't do that. They're not in a situation to do that. So we also do have to look at what are the dollars that are available. And that influences whether or not you can have good training. It influences whether you can get the follow-up training, whether you can get behavioral skills training and coaching that goes along with that.
Well, Susan, you provided us a nice overview of a range of client variables, client preference, biological factors, kind of resource constraints. Are there any other contextual variables that you'd like the BCBAs to be cognizant of that might have an impact on their selection and tailoring of evidence-based practices into their practice?
Well, I would say, again, to go back from our early years when Mount Wolf started talking about social validity, we have to be looking at how feasible these are, the treatments are. We have to look at how acceptable they are. You know, our goal is to remove ourselves eventually. To remove the need for intervention procedures altogether is the ideal, but certainly to reduce the need for our services. And that I think that's unlikely to happen if we're not looking at whether or not the behavior change agent finds the treatment acceptable. Again, very often people will feel compelled to say yes to your face, or may even think, I'm going to give this a try, but really they don't find the treatment all that acceptable. They don't think it works for their lives, or they don't think it's right for their child. Very often people go to physicians and the same thing happens. So I don't think it's unique to our field, but since we know that happens, we need to make sure that we are assessing whether or not people are finding an intervention to be acceptable. But we also need to look at what's maintaining the behavior of the behavior change agent. So do we need to build into the intervention how often that they're getting praise for accurately implementing the intervention? Is there, if you work in a school system, for example, is there some reward that an administrator can offer to a teacher that's really implementing a complex intervention with fidelity? We should be looking at the exact same variables, whether the teacher gets a substitute in, so she gets a break, or he gets a break to work on other things, or whether there's you get pizza at the local pizza parlor. But we need to be looking at these variables as well. I would also say, in terms of anxiety for the people who are involved in the interventions, we need to be assessing how strong is their anxiety related to implementing a complex intervention, and how can we reduce that anxiety to an optimal level so that they're working hard at implementing the intervention, but they're not so overwhelmed that it wouldn't be possible to implement the intervention right. And when we ignore that and just say, well, they're not trying hard enough, or they just don't seem to get it, we would never do that for our clients, the person whose behavior we're trying to change. So we should never do it for our clients, defined broadly as to include those behavior change agents.
Well, it's nice that you're thinking about the behavior change agents in particular. And it is also worth noting that sometimes supplemental reinforcing consequences above and beyond just seeing your child or your student or your client do well is sometimes necessary to maintain their commitment and their behavior. I'm wondering whether we need to think about a couple different ways we do maintenance. One of them is, you teach a child to ride a bicycle, they get hooked into the naturally occurring reinforcers. You don't have to have contrived contingencies to teach the child to keep on riding the bicycle, or once you learn to read, to keep on learning to read. So that's one type of way we do kind of maintenance gains. But not everything produces those naturally occurring contingencies to capture the behavior and keep it going, such as, I love my job, but if I don't get paid to go to work, eventually I'm going to have to find some other way to put, you know, food on the table and stuff like that. But that's a type of long-term prosthetic set of contingencies to keep me going. And part of what you're describing here is when you don't have that naturally occurring reinforcers, you may have to think along the lines of what is the long-term behavioral prosthetic environment that needs to be out there, and how do you keep it going?
Absolutely.
Does that kind of process, that model, make any sense to you a little bit?
It absolutely does. And both sides of that are important, though. So, for example, one of the things that I've always tried to do is identify data collection procedures for people who are the behavior change agents that are reasonable for them. I don't expect them to collect the same kind of data I collect when I conduct research. When they're collecting data and I'm focusing on behaviors that I'm improving, then they're much more likely to get excited. I'm much less likely to need external reinforcers because they see their own data. I teach them to graph their own data and they say, wow, I'm making such a difference. Or, oh, yeah, yesterday was so hard, but it was worth it, right? And so they're much more likely to be able to do that. So I do think that that's something that we should all be doing. But we need to make sure that when we use those kinds of data collection procedures, we're not developing data collection procedures that are so onerous that they are not it's not possible to do your job at the same time, or not do it and still be able to enjoy what you're doing. So that's just one more thing to add, finding a way to help them see that what they're doing is making a difference.
Yeah, so you lower the response effort and you increase the
That's right.
visibility and effectiveness of the response consequences.
That's exactly right.
Good strategy. Susan, we've talked about a lot of factors to consider mm-hmm. as you're thinking about this evidence-based model, everything from how do you look at the literature and evaluate the relevance and the quality of the literature to all these different variables that need to be considered. Could you kind of walk us through how this would actually occur
Sure.
in reality?
Sure.
Help us with that a little bit.
Absolutely, because I think that if you don't do that, then it's a lot of words that make sense, but we can't necessarily translate that. It's much like when we just tell a teacher or a parent, this is all you have to do, but we don't show them, we don't watch them. And so I did want to provide an example. And so I thought I would start out with the National Standards Project. As we discussed, I used to be the executive director of the National Autism Center, and I chaired the first National Standards Project. That was in 2009, and earlier this year, a second National Standards Project came out. I would encourage everyone to go to the website for the National Autism Center. You'll be able to access it for free from that website. And what's nice about the document, it includes a slight description of this process, but it also explains in great detail how did they evaluate the literature. And I think that to be a critical consumer, as we've talked about, you need to know that piece of it, as well as which are the treatments that were demonstrated to be the most effective, which ones have some emerging evidence, but not enough evidence yet for us to be confident this intervention is making a difference, and which one really have no data to suggest that this is where we should begin. So my first thing that I do would be to look at that National Standards Project or any similar document and avoid using any of those that have no evidence of effectiveness. That allows me, unfortunately, to remove a lot of interventions right from the get-go. Now I've got those with a good amount of support and those that have some support. Well, I'm also going to put at a lower priority. I'm not going to eliminate them, but I'm going to set as a lower priority those interventions that have just a little bit of evidence. Because the good news is there are 14 interventions that have been identified as having good evidence for children on the spectrum. And also one intervention, behavioral interventions, that make a difference for older individuals on the spectrum. Older individuals on the spectrum, they've been around for much longer than people think about. And there's unfortunately far more limited data with that age group, but we need to be looking at that age group separately in order to make sure that we're focusing on the right goals, for example. Anyway.
So it sounds like you're covering the full age spectrum right here.
That's right.
And the other thing that's worth also noting is that this is a living document, isn't it, Susan? Mm-hmm. So that as evidence accumulates for things that might have had no evidence, they sometimes move into different categories.
That's right.
Or you could even have people move in the other direction.
Absolutely.
It'd be a little unlikely, but I can imagine, you know, yep. that new things show up, move into different strategies. So it's a yep. living document, right?
And it is, and you're absolutely right. Something could move down. Right. So for example, if today we had multiple studies that were well controlled that showed the treatment worked. Well, worked for what? It may be that it works for some purposes and it actually makes things worse for others, or it doesn't work for other things. Or it may be that we learn that there is a side effect that's so great that we would say we wouldn't recommend this any longer. So yes, absolutely, any treatments can move anywhere at any time. That's part of having that best available evidence. Always that evidence base will be changing. But where will I start? I'll start by looking at those 14 treatments that have generally been shown to be efficacious. That doesn't tell me that it's perfect. It only tells me these are the 14 that I'm going to begin considering. So I'm going to describe for you a client, and we're going to go through and look at preferences and repertoire and the contextual variables, and we're going to decide of these 14 treatments, which ones are going to be the best. I'm going to put those glasses on you talked about earlier. And read to you the interventions that are currently identified as established. Behavioral interventions, cognitive behavioral interventions, comprehensive behavioral treatment for young children, language training for the purpose of producing language, modeling, natural teaching strategies, parent training, peer training, pivotal response training, schedules, scripting, self-management, social skills packages, and story-based interventions. So that's a long list. So even if I just want to restrict myself to those top 14, I still have some professional decisions to make, and now I'm going to be looking at the client. So let's say I've got a young man, I'm going to call him Jamel. He is on the spectrum, but he's considered high-functioning. He seems to have pretty good communication skills, although his abstract communication is weaker. I would say all five-year-olds' abstract communication is weaker, so I'm going to put that in context. And he has difficulty sometimes paying attention. He's fully included in school and making progress, but the teacher does report some concerns about his ability to attend. Socially, he's not as engaged as other children, but the teacher says he's making improvements. So what's the concern? The concern is he demonstrates a lot of dangerous behaviors. He loves to climb on tall objects and jump off of them. He will just run, because he's not paying attention, will just run into walls or objects or people, and so he could knock other students down. And he's not, he also does things like, a hot stove, he would put his hand up there, or an electrical socket, he might touch that. So he demonstrates a wide range of potential safety concerns that really do need to be addressed. He's not on medications, but he has significant sleep onset problems. So in the evenings, his parents are up with him pretty late because he just won't seem to go to sleep. For his parents both have full-time jobs. Mom is also going to graduate school, and Dad is busy with community service organization, so he belongs to the Rotary. His parents are also not getting any sleep because they're staying up with Jamel, and sleep can have an impact both on their behavior and on his. They also have twin daughters that are 7, so they have a busy family life. Let's talk about Jamel's teacher. She has 5 years' experience, which is great. She has 25 other kids in the class. One of those also has an autism spectrum disorder. There are 3 that have ADHD. Funding for this school district has been getting weaker and weaker, and she finds herself having to buy a lot of her own supplies. So it's not the ideal environment. So when I look at, based on this information alone, it helps me start looking at that list of 14, and I can start saying, okay, what am I going to eliminate? Well, I already know the comprehensive behavioral treatment for young children is usually 25 to 40 hours a week. He's making progress in lots of areas. Why would I move him to a far more restrictive environment? So I can already say this is a very low priority in terms of whether I would consider that. Language production. He's not having a problem with language production, so I can eliminate that. I can give that a very low priority. Cognitive behavioral interventions. Yes, there's some evidence that they are effective, good evidence that they can be effective, but not with five-year-olds with autism, and so I'm going to remove that as a possibility as well. So my list of 14 is already down to 11. What about social skills? He's already making social skill improvement. And the social skills package is not likely to be effective in addressing dangerous behavior anyway. So I can eliminate that as a possibility. I'm going to give that a very low priority. So already I've been able to eliminate or reduce the likelihood that I would use several of these. Now I'm going to look at preference. And I will actually do a preference assessment. I've done a preference assessment with Jamel, and he doesn't care about attention. It's not a reinforcer for him. He is happy to keep working, but he does have some control over his own breaks, so a break card means nothing to him. edibles are occasionally valuable. I suspect that's when he hasn't eaten in a while. That's not a very complicated thing to figure out. But activities, he's a very active kid. Part of, you know, he loves climbing up on things, but he also loves running around on the playground. He likes playing around with basketball and soccer, lots of activities that he likes to do. The good news is they have used reinforcement-based interventions with him before, and he's responded well, particularly when it's related to those activities. So that already gives us some good information. The other great news is when he has access to those activities, we see a really positive affect. He's smiling, he's laughing. And when he does not earn them, his response is pretty appropriate. We don't see a lot of problem behaviors. But we also know that in the past, they did use a punishment-based procedure with him. And then we saw not just crying and whining, but we actually saw some aggression and self-injury. It's the only time that we've seen that with him. So we know that those are the kinds of things that we would want to avoid doing. They have used a token economy in the past, and that seemed to work as long as he could exchange his tokens pretty quickly. And they have used picture schedules with him before. And a nice thing that's been added is a question mark picture. And the question mark means he goes up to his teacher, his parents, and asks, what do I do next? And we've started putting that in there so that he could be more flexible with his schedule. If something changed, that they could deal with that. So he's got a really broad skill set. He complies with a lot of commands. So when I look at my interventions, I see some that have actually worked before. I'm likely to focus on, in this list, the category called behavioral interventions, as well as schedules, because I know both of these have worked before. I'm not going to eliminate the other choices, but I'm going to give a higher priority to these. And I'm going to go back and look at some of these other variables that we talked about. Our supporting environment, for example. In the home, we've already talked about what busy, hectic lives the family have. They've got work, they've got school, they've got other children. The parents had previously had Jamel in a center, and Jamel made great progress, but they felt like they didn't get training, and they wished that they had more training. They're thrilled with how much progress he made, but they're still not quite sure what to do with him at home. Let's go back to his teacher. His teacher, like we said, has lots of other students, and some of those have special needs. She also has a paraprofessional in the classroom with no experience whatsoever. There's a lot of turnover in the school for paraprofessionals. A lot of his more dangerous behavior happens on the playground, and they're constantly rotating who's on the playground. So that can also be a little bit of a tricky issue. That paraprofessional, we need that much more that paraprofessional to be available and well-trained. So immediately, I start looking at treatments that are extremely time-consuming are probably going to be not as good. So there are some beautiful treatments that I just love to use, like pivotal response training, but I don't necessarily need to use something that is that comprehensive, for example, or that it's as time-consuming as it is to do right, to really do the way it's supposed to be done. The same with naturalistic teaching strategies and also peer training. Peer training is a wonderful strategy that I love to use, but it involves the professionals knowing what they're doing to train and facilitate with the peers. And my goodness, if I don't have enough resources in that classroom, that's certainly going to be one that I'm going to give a lower priority. So now we've been able to reduce more. What about that environmental and resource constraint that we talked about? Well, there is an iPad available in the home, and there's also one available at school. But the one at school, there are lots of other children that also like to use it. If I'm looking at things like schedules, because that's one of my higher priorities, the parents don't have any lamination capacity at home. And at school, again, there are limited resources for lamination. At home, what else is going on? The parents are tired. They're so tired, I want to make sure that whatever intervention I develop, that it's very feasible. There may also be other issues that come to bear there. So for example, I may say parent training. Parent training is one of those interventions that has been demonstrated to be effective. Maybe I need to do some parent training with them to work on compliance surrounding sleep. Or we may need to have them work with a sleep specialist if I'm not able to help them with the sleep protocol. So now I've looked at my interventions. Those behavioral interventions make sense. And the schedules make sense, even with the environmental and resource constraint. But I need to figure out, how do I want to adapt those for this child with this context? And this is where my professional judgment comes in. For the behavioral intervention, the token economy has worked before. The teacher knows how to implement the token economy. Why wouldn't I begin by selecting one that requires the lowest response effort given the limited resources that teacher has? But I'm going to want to make sure it's set up so that he can exchange those tokens a couple of times a day at school and implement it at home as well with exchanging it a couple of times at home. I'm going to tie that to that daily preference assessment. For schedules, I'm going to consider, let's try starting out with the iPad. And even though there are limited iPads at school, I might talk to home and see if he can be sent to school with the iPad, as long as the teacher can ensure it gets into his backpack and he gets home. So as I develop this intervention, I'm also going to be looking at this social validity. Once I develop this intervention, I'm going to be asking them, what do you think of this? Does this seem feasible? Are you okay with this? Is it something that once I train you, that I can step away from this and that you would be willing to continue doing? I want to ask that question rather directly. I'm also going to be looking at the contingencies in the natural environment. While I know that the teacher, the paraprofessional is extremely anxious right now because this child is a safety risk. She has responsibility for this child. And so she's highly motivated if I can give her an intervention that is manageable, that is feasible given her inexperience, and that's going to keep this child safe. The teacher is going to be thrilled if I can use some of the internal consultants in the school, because now I've outsourced some of the work, and that's less demand on the teacher, who's already got a lot of things on her plate. For the parents, I can also, if I get the right intervention in place, reduce their anxiety around the safety risk, but also the sleep deprivation issue. So again, I'm going to want to make sure that I include a sleep intervention. So that's the process I go to for selecting an intervention. But remember, selecting is really selecting and adapting the intervention. But remember, that's really where we're starting. I think back to when I was a kid, I loved Sherlock Holmes. And in one of his books, he has Sherlock Holmes says, data, 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 I cannot make bricks without clay. And I think about that, even though we've gone through this process of looking, this is what the literature says, and these are all the relevant client variables, and these are all the relevant contextuals. And so we've got this intervention that we think is fantastic. We don't know if we're not collecting data. One of the most dangerous things that we can do is assume just because something appears on a list that it's absolutely going to be effective. So we really can't do that. We have to monitor the progress to make sure that the kids are making success. So, if we're not assessing the client progress and also the continuing treatment acceptability, we're more likely to see that the intervention isn't doing quite what we want it to do. And that's the general process that we use.
Well, Susan, what you've described with that case example is just a marvelous multi-component decision-making process that leads to the selection and implementation and kind of ongoing clinical evaluation of some sort of intervention. I would suppose that it would work all the time, most of the time, or whatever, but what do you advise for your BCBAs that are watching this? What happens if, in spite of your very best efforts, mm-hmm. you aren't getting the response to treatment you'd like? And sure. Of course, you have an obligation to monitor clinical progress, and I can't overemphasize that enough, but how about if you aren't getting the response to treatment that you very much like?
Sure. Well, we know that because we've collected data, and the data never lie. And so the first thing we want to do is actually look at treatment fidelity. Is the intervention being implemented with fidelity? We have tried to develop an intervention considering these complex contextual issues, but it doesn't mean that necessarily it has done an adequate job with that. So the first thing I always do is I look at treatment fidelity. But assuming that treatment fidelity is where it needs to be, the next thing I'm going to do is to go back to my list of treatments that have been shown to be effective. Remember those systematic reviews, whether it's the National Standards Project or a systematic review you would read about in a journal, none of these are perfect. And again, even if they were perfect, you'd have to extrapolate to your current situation, but you want to be a critical consumer of those. You want to make sure that the document you relied on to begin with is a strong document, and you know the limitations of the document. No one has time to read all of the literature. There's just too much literature out there. So this, having these kinds of evidence-based practice guidelines can really help people invest their resources so that they get better training in the treatments that work. But there are also a challenge in making sure that they're not using them in a way that, you assume that every treatment is going to be equally effective. I assume it's always an empirical question, no matter what process I use. And so it may be that I have to tweak an intervention, or as I said, add a different intervention or replace an intervention. And that I would go through the same process, the same evidence-based practice, where I look at the literature, I look at the contextual variables, I combine that information, I use my professional judgment to combine that information and to identify, okay, what's the best treatment. But I also think it's really important that when you're looking for that best available evidence, that you're realizing most often people are generating a list, and that's really just a beginning. That there are lots of people that may use that list and say, look, I'm doing it because it's on this list, and they're not actually doing it accurately. The outcome is not going to be as good. So in a given case, like I've described, I would do, as I said, I would go back to my model, and it's an iterative process. I would go through the whole process again. But I also just felt like it was important to share kind of a warning for people who think that these evidence-based practice guidelines they're not an implementation guideline. And just because somebody says they're using something off a list does not mean they're doing evidence-based practice or even implementing an intervention accurately.
And that's a great point, actually, because I think that what you've described, this is a marvelous starting point, some of the evidence-based practice comprehensive reviews. Mm-hmm. But even when you look at the categories, there's multiple interventions within behavioral intervention. There's
yes.
multiple behavioral procedures within cognitive behavior therapy. Mm-hmm. So you sometimes still have to drill down and understand
that's right.
which specific ones, what principles are we operating with. So that's one of the places where the science and the conceptual model matches on a little
Absolutely.
Bit. Okay. Now, let me ask you one other question about the National Standards Project mm-hmm. and other things of that nature. Behavior analysis seems to emphasize a lot, and I think very appropriately, functional behavior analysis. Mm-hmm. How do you begin to build that variable or that consideration in to selecting interventions out of a national standards project or anything of that nature, Susan?
That's right. Absolutely. The function of the behavior and the function-based intervention are still central, even when you select these interventions. It's to me, it focuses more on when we identify the function of behavior, there are a huge number of function-based interventions that we might develop. You know, just because I identify a function, it's not like this function gets this treatment all of the time. And so the evidence-based practice of applied behavior analysis allows us to consider those variables that help us select which of those function-based interventions is most likely to produce a positive outcome.
Well, that provides a marvelous overview, Susan, of evidence-based practice and the comprehensive complex model, how it applies to applied behavior analysis. And you've given us a picture of where we are now. Could I ask you to think future-wise, where would you like us to be in a decade? What do you see as the upcoming challenges in evidence-based practice and applied behavior analysis, and where do we need to move the discipline and move our practitioners to?
Sure. When a group of us first started talking at this at national conferences, there were people that were actively resistant to the idea. I think that's changing, but I certainly wouldn't say that's gone altogether. The other piece of resistance I sometimes get is, this is just too hard. It is hard. It really is hard. And I don't want to undermine that. But each of these pieces is part of our rich literature going back to the 1960s. So none of this, the evidence-based practice of applied behavior analysis, we're not introducing, oh, you have to do all of these new things. We're giving you a framework for pulling all of these things together. And what I hope to have happen in the next decade is for universities to be teaching the evidence-based practice of applied behavior analysis more. Because I think what happens for many of our students, they see it on a list for the BCBA exam, or they see it on the ethics code, and so they think, okay, I need to know this for an exam. And they don't think about how you actually integrate all of these pieces. And this is a model that helps students, but also practitioners, figure out all of these pieces that we as a field already endorse. This is how they fit together. And if our universities do, I think, a stronger job at teaching the evidence-based practice of applied behavior analysis, I think we'll end up with stronger practitioners in the end.
I couldn't agree with you more, Susan. And I would point out that what we have on this videotape is one piece in that dissemination mm-hmm. about how do you do evidence-based practice and applied behavior analysis. So with that, let me thank you very much for your contributions with this videotape series, and especially for your expertise and explanation of evidence-based practice and applied behavior analysis. Thank you so much, Susan.
Well, thank you.